The Nigerian authorities must end their attempts to cover up the Lekki Toll Gate killings, Amnesty International warns. And Information Minister Lai Mohammed calls for regulation of social media. This is Plus Politics. I am Kayode Ladeindi. Welcome to Plus Politics. This is not the first time Amnesty International is on collision course with the federal government on human rights related issues. This time around, the two parties' evidences are of keen interest to many on what is the truth and what is falsehood. Joining us to discuss this, we have Nelson Ekwujimi, who is a public affairs analyst and legal practitioner. Evans Ufeli. Good evening, gentlemen.
Thank you. Good evening.
Okay, let me start with Nelson. Nelson, I think I've been following you closely and I've seen some of the comments you said about the Amnesty International report. For the benefit of our viewers, what is your opinion about the Amnesty International's report on the issue that happened on Lekki Toll Gate?
Well, thank you very much. My position on the Lekki Toll Gate incident is that, one, I was privy to have watched this live streaming of that alleged incident on phone via the author by name DJ Switch or whatever the name is. I'm not too sure. And on watching that video, she made some comments that tickled my, my inquisitiveness. I recollect when she was saying, "Oh, they are shooting us. Oh, we are removing bullets from those that have been shot." And you know, I was shocked that even in war situations, the mix will take victims or people injured out of the safe zones. So for me, the Lekki incident is one that I want to, you know, have an open mind with regards to. That wait, the government, the Lagos State government has set up a panel of inquiry made up of men and women of integrity and character. And I don't want to jump the gun. I am an intellectual. As a person, I subject every issue, you know, to critical logic and logical analysis. And that is what that is what differentiates me from an animal. That when things are thrown at me, I must look at it thoroughly using my intellect that I've been bestowed with by the Almighty. I must not be somebody that when something is thrown at me, I will just take it hook, line, and sinker. I'm not a zombie. So for me, there is more, you know, to that issue that meets the eye. And that is why I have implicit confidence in the panel of inquiry and restitution to unearth what happened at that venue on that day. I don't want to jump the gun to say, like some people have already been saying, but which they have, you know, started recanting. You recollect that they started with a massacre, genocide, bloodbath. But today, the music has changed.
Okay.
So I want to remain consistent. I also recollect that several footages that we saw of alleged persons who were killed, quite a number of them have come out publicly to deny that they were ever near the incident. And for me, that is troublesome that, you know, even if an incident has happened, if we try to doctor it or we try to, you know, embellish it, it will destroy the fact of our case.
Nelson,
it is in our own collective
interest. Nelson, I don't want you to exhaust all the points that you have, because I have some issues to actually clear with you based on what you said. Let me move to Evans. What do you think about the whole episode? We have heard different stories. The Lagos State Governor has come out to say that it's been looking for families, it's been looking for who is affected by these shootings. What can you say from what you've seen so far?
Well, from a clear perspective, on that fateful day, the 20th of October 2020, there was, before then, there have been a peaceful demonstration at the Lekki Toll Gate, which is evident. Everyone have seen that the protesters had conducted themselves in manners that meets with international best practice. Apart from the hoodlums who were not really coordinated, who were actually a different set of collectives. But as to what happened on that day, the soldiers actually were deployed at the scene. They were seen by all and sundry. They shot the protesters. After that, the governor was actually interviewed and he said that there were no shooting and there were no fatalities and all that. 2 days back, he was interviewed by the CNN, and on CNN, straight questions were put to him. All of a sudden, he backtracked from his earlier position and came to the conclusion that two persons were actually shot. The governor was on the site. The governor visited those who were injured at the hospital and came back with reports. And he was able to, you know, make that allusion with clarity to the CNN broadcaster that interviewed him on the issue. Now, as for Amnesty, Amnesty earlier reported that 12 persons were killed. My own position as to Amnesty is that Amnesty is an international human rights organization that must bring evidence to make clarity on all her allusions. When they brought out a report about the number of persons killed at the Northeast by the insurgency, the federal government, you know, came up with a denial that no, the Amnesty couldn't have gotten that report, that the number is not up to that. But the federal government itself will not give you any accurate figure or statistics that is clear that you can rely on. Now, Femi Adesina was interviewed by Channel TV a few days ago, and he said Amnesty does not run Nigeria. The Amnesty cannot say that 12 persons died. And then Femi Adesina saying that was talking as if the federal government is running Nigeria. Is the federal government really in control of this country? Because nature abhors vacuum. Where the federal government is always not truthful, not clear, not open with the way it goes about managing this society, then you cannot begin to blame Amnesty International wholesomely for giving you reports. How be it that such report must be backed by evidence?
Okay.
My only grounds with Amnesty International is that the evidence should be clear on their reportage and reports. But as to the federal government saying that Amnesty does not run Nigeria, I think that is counterproductive and that is wrong.
Okay.
Because if you as the federal government is running Nigeria effectively, you should have the record, you should have the reports, you should have everything.
And we should
depend on
yourself.
The military came out not too long ago, just 2 days ago, to say that they were actually invited by the Lagos State government.
Evans, trust me, it's an issue we will touch if time permits us. We focused largely on that yesterday, but for the benefit of those who didn't listen to the program, they might also, if you're lucky, to get into that. But let's stay with the Amnesty International report. Nelson, you mentioned the people who were backtracking their claims, and we are also having government, according to Evans too, who are also backtracking their claims. So where do we run to? Do we have to wait for a panel of inquiry before we can see the obvious? And what exactly do you think? Who should we trust at this time?
Well, currently, when the incident happened and there was this uproar, the governor visited the alleged victims at the hospital, and the governor now made the statement that, oh, this shooting or this attack must have been from the military, and that he didn't invite the military, and that because he is not in the military process for deployment of the military to, you know, to quell the protesters. That he has written to the military and that is in contact with our president. From that statement, you should know clearly that the governor was speaking from the point of view as the governor, as not as a military personnel, because he wasn't in the structure of the military hierarchy to know if the troops were deployed. He spoke from the emotional point of view, like a lot of us would have done, seeing the video of that, you know, incident. And immediately, the military came out and said, looking at that video, that they didn't deploy their men and that their men were not responsible for it. And as we speak today, the military has continued to maintain that stand. Don't forget, just 2 days ago, the military released a statement in which it said that sequel to the imposition of a 24-hour curfew, and as a result of violence that led to the killing, to the burning of police stations, the killing of policemen, the attack on correctional facilities, and the release of, you know, inmates, that the military was invited by the Lagos state government, which shows clearly that the position of Mr. Governor, that as at on the 20th, he didn't invite the military, and which reaffirmed the position of the military, that, look, why we came in was from after the 20th, when the governor had imposed a curfew.
Okay, Nelson.
And when the governor saw that there was a breakdown of law and order, and that was why the military was invited in after
Nelson, Nelson, that sounds to me like interpretative now, because I read through that document, and probably your inference might be different from mine. But let me allow Evans to give me his own perception, because I think what you're saying is different from what Nelson is explaining to us.
With due respect to Mr. Nelson Ekujimi, that position is wrong. It is wrong because the curfew was declared on the 20th, that same day. The president said, the governor said that it will start from 4 p.m. When he later discovered that it's impracticable because of traffic and a lot of people have gone to work, he now shifted it to 9 p.m. Now, between that 4 p.m. and 9 p.m., the army attacked the protesters around 7:45 to 8 p.m. So, if you say that he invited the army to enforce the curfew, how come that the enforcement came before 9 p.m.? That is the issue. Because the level of contradiction and the level of denial and lies that the government is peddling in this issue, it's one that is practically unfortunate. And I think that we must appraise this issue carefully. That is why I do not have faith in the governor's panel of inquiry. Because the governor is an interested party in this case. And having set up that inquiry by Section 5 of the Panel of Inquiries Act of Lagos State, Panel of Inquiry Laws of Lagos State, 2017, I think that the governor is an interested party. And as such, the panel must be extricated and be independent from his influence. Because we also have come in contact with a lot of issues about that panel of inquiry on the issue of taking oath of secrecy and the rest of it. Section 5 of that law that empowered the governor to, you know, bring that panel of inquiry into force have no provision for an oath of secrecy. That is why it is important we do not push the international communities away. Let the international communities do their own investigation too, just like the panel of inquiry, they are doing their own investigation.
Okay.
So that we can have independent and parallel body and not maintain any kind of monopoly in the system.
Evans, your position is noted, but let me go back to Nelson. One question I want to ask as a moderator is, can you help me connect these two points? Ami said their men were not there. They were not at the Lekki Toll Gate, that particular hour. And 81 Division said Lagos State government invited us, but we did not shoot at the protesters. Isn't that contradictory?
No, Kayode, please, let me make this correction.
Okay.
The military, not the army, because I've listened to the military spokesperson, Major General Eneche.
Eneche.
The military was not invited to enforce the curfew. Please get it very clear. The military was invited as a result of violence, the burning of police stations, the release of inmates in police cells, the killing of policemen. The military was never invited to enforce curfew. Please go and read that press release from the Nigerian military. Like the Major General Eneche rightly said, the military is made up of not only the army, so we should stop, you know, misconstruing it to be only the army. The military is made up of the army, the navy, the air force, and other paramilitary agencies. He has made it very clear that they were never invited to come and enforce the curfew, that they were invited 24 hours after the imposition of the curfew, and due to the breakdown of law and order, due to violence. They were invited when police stations were being burned. You recollect that it was after the Lekki incident that police stations such as Orile-Egbomu police station was burnt, Amukoko police station was burnt, Lawani police station was burnt, and several other stations, police stations across the state, as well as the killing of policemen. So the military was never invited to come and enforce the curfew. Please, let us get that very, very clear. Then the military saying that they were not involved in the shooting in Lekki. If you go back to the military
statement,
they did not
shoot at the protesters.
They made it very clear that we were invited 24 hours after the imposition of a 24-hour curfew. I read it. I'm a graduate that was, you know, that was tutored in English language, and I have a very good comprehension of that statement. I will encourage any discerning Nigerian without mischief motive to go and read it. The message or the writing of the press release from the military is very, very clear.
Very clear.
That we were invited 24 hours by the Lagos State government after the imposition of 24-hour curfew, and as a result of violence, which led to the burning of police stations, killing of policemen, release of prison attack on prison on correctional facilities. It was as a result of violence that the Lagos State government invited the military not
okay,
to
Nelson.
Come and enforce the
Nelson.
Imposition of curfew. Please.
I must commend you for your bold, audacious position, because this looks very, very unpopular. But let me go back to Evans. Interestingly, I'm also aware that Evans also read English before he read law. Is that something we are missing from that statement?
You see, the statement released by the military is not sacrosanct because it is defensive. The military can release any press statement. Anybody can release any kind of statement. We have to look at fact and evidence with time and dates. The military were seen at the scene on the same day where the protesters were at the protest ground at Lekki Toll Gate. Okay? And on that day, there are video and pictorial evidence of how they opened fire on the protesters. The entire world saw it. So this is not a case of what the military released or what the military did not release. Kayode, I have a strong military background. In fact, my first 30 years was within the military arena. Okay, so I know the military formation. The military will not move without the hierarchy and the order coming from the hierarchy. There was an order made to them, and they got to the site and disrupted the protest. Now, the governor of Lagos State spoke to CNN and said the same thing. You cannot say you know more than about this. You cannot say you know more than the Lagos State governor on the issue of what transpired. And he has made all these allusions and has made clarity to that fact.
Okay.
Okay. So this is a clear case of military shooting at armless civilians, armless protesters, okay, against the Geneva Convention, against the UN human rights protocols and all international protocols, you know, known to mankind.
Okay, let me quickly clean this up before we round off this segment. Now, the essence is to look at what the federal government did say about Amnesty International, that they've been very, very consistent in reporting falsehood. And, you know, Amnesty says that do not attempt to cover up what you did wrong. So, Nelson, in clear terms, how do we get our facts right and ensure that what we say is something we can go home with, and rather than running to Amnesty International?
Yes, thank you. Unlike Evans, I have implicit confidence in the character and integrity of the men and women who have been consulted into that panel of inquiry and restitution. I don't think it is appropriate for Amnesty to try to blackmail the government of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, be it the Lagos State government or the federal government. If they don't have confidence in that panel, it is appropriate for them to come out publicly and state it. Right now, members of that panel is even made up of representatives from the civil society, as well as from the legal profession. So, and we have a justice who is heading that panel. So if anybody has a misgiving about that panel, it is for that person to point it out, rather than, you know, trying to blackmail, you know, by saying they should not cover up. I'm sure members of that panel have not come out publicly to say we are being gagged. So as a Nigerian, like I said earlier on, I want to keep an open mind. I don't want to rush to judgment. I have confidence in the panel that panel will do justice. If any other person or group do not have confidence in the panel, then I think, you know, they are free, you know, and they are entitled to their opinion. But for me, as a patriotic Nigerian, I believe in that panel to unearth whatever happened on the 20th of October 2020 at the Lekki Toll Gate.
We'll be unraveled. Thank you so much. Let me quickly get Evan's final comment. One thing we should also remember is that what the panel was set up for is not just the Lekki shooting. It was even set up before that shooting to look at the cases of human rights abuses done by the disbanded operatives of SARS. So in context, sticking to Lekki, do you think you should give the panel some benefit of doubt?
Yeah, well, of course. It's not. I am not dismissing the panel in its entirety, because I know that apart from the Lekki issue was just added into their jurisdiction. And the main issue why they were set up was to look at the cases of human rights abuse by policemen, SARS, and the rest of them. And then the Lagos State government came up with some funds for which they will use to, you know, compensate, or like a form of restitution for those who have been highly affected by the. But what I'm saying clearly is that the federal government should admit mistakes. If you have made a mistake, the best way to go about it is to tell the people you are sorry. Okay, whether an order was made, is to tell the people that you inadvertently, sent soldiers to that spot, and the soldiers carried out that dastardly act for which people were injured. Because you cannot run away from the truth. That is it. The posterity will judge all of us according to our deeds. These people committed no offense and they were shot at. That is the truth. So there's no point, there's no amount of covering up, talking from both sides of the mouth and all that, for you to shred that. And let me also say that patriotism really does, it's not loyalty to Buhari. Patriotism is loyalty to Nigeria.
Thank you so much, Evans Ofeli, for your position. And thank you once again, Nelson Akujumi, for your intervention on this issue. The issue continues on all our social media platforms. Let's continue the conversation there. They can always follow Nelson. They can also follow Evans. I hope that the goal for every one of us here is to unravel the truth and nothing but the truth. Thank you so much once again, gentlemen. And to our viewers, please don't go away. We'll take a short break. And when we return, the argument to regulate social media is heating up yet again, especially in the wake of recent NSAS protests. We'll be back after the break.